the tomb. The book of Hagar. Chapter 2. The glory of this latter house. The glory of this latter house shall be greater than of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts. Hallelujah. Stop right there. We chose for a subject today. You ain't seen nothing yet. You ain't seen nothing yet. Look at your neighbor, say neighbor. You ain't seen nothing yet. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor, say neighbor. Oh neighbor. You ain't seen nothing yet. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand of praise. I won't be before you long. We already pretty much, you might as well say, I've done the introduction. Amen. Because what we experience in this place just was a different level, amen, from the time that I've been here. But wherever you are in your life, you ain't seen nothing yet. We studied a few weeks ago, I have not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the hearts of men what God has prepared for them who love him and are called according to his purpose. You haven't seen anything, or you haven't seen nothing yet. And in talking about this, Hagar chapter 2, the Old Testament, amen. Hagar, if you hear it, he was considered to be a minor prophet. And he's not a minor prophet because anything had to do with his character or anything that like of that nature. It's called a minor prophet because they didn't write a whole lot. Amen. And so you're seeing Hagar, there are only two chapters. Amen. But if you read these two chapters, there's a lot of punch in these two chapters. And the situation is this. After the Jews had been captured by the Babylonians and they were in slavery, when the Persians came along and conquered the Babylonians, the Jews were allowed to return back home. And they were allowed to return back home unto their homeland, and more importantly, they were allowed to return back to Jerusalem. And when the Babylonians came in, because they were such a destructive nation, they destroyed the temple of God. Amen. They destroyed the temple of God. So when they went back, when the Jews went back to the land, they started to work to rebuild the temple. But somewhere down the line, like we do sometimes, we lose focus. And somewhere down the line, they lost focus and they only started to build their own houses back up. Amen. Does it sound familiar? Sometimes we lose focus in the things of God and then we just start focusing on our houses, on ourselves. So they start to build their own houses and they left the work of the temple undone. Let me say that again. They started worrying about themselves and building their own houses and beautifying their own houses, but they forgot about the temple and they left the temple's work undone. The temple which shows and which presents itself as the presence of God, they let that work go undone. Uh-huh. And so then Haggai, being the prophet of God, he called them to action. Uh-huh. And told them there is work for them to do. Amen. And so, allow me a few minutes. We're not going to be before you long at all. Allow me a few minutes. Look at verse number 3, if you will. He says, "Who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? And how do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison of it as nothing?" And what was happening there, they saw the first temple, and the first temple was built by Solomon himself. And Solomon arrayed the temple of God with all these different things, gold and silver, and he made great columns. And he really had the temple of God looking good. I mean, people travel for miles around just to see the glories of God that Solomon had erected, that he had built. And he built this great temple. He used all the resources that was in his disposal, and he brought all of that into the temple, and he built it, and it was something magnificent and something glorious to see. And now, in comparison, when they are building their temple, the Bible here says, "What does your temple look like in compared to Solomon's temple?" Amen. Because the first temple was destroyed. Amen. And so my baby like to use this terminology. She says that this world is an illusion. In other words, what you see is not exactly what's happening. What you see is not exactly what's going on. He says, so now, look at this temple in comparison to the old temple. And you're looking at it now and you say, well, my temple ain't nothing. Uh-huh. Amen. That is the illusion. I want you to check this out and see as we go a little further. Look at verse 4. He says, "Yet now be strong, O Zerubbabel, saith the Lord, and be strong, O Joshua, son of Zosedek, the high priest, and be strong, all ye people of the land, saith the Lord, and work, for I am with you, saith the Lord of hosts." And so what he is showing them is, he says, listen, don't worry about the other temple. I want you to be strong. I'm going to make a comparison here in a minute. I want you to see, he said, listen, don't you fall for the illusion of everything that was going on. Because really, if you think about it, when the other temple was up, people weren't worshiping and praising me like they should have been anyway. Because if they was focusing so much on me, then I wouldn't have to take them in captivity in the first place.
Amen.
So he said, listen, don't you pay attention to the illusion. I say to you today, don't you pay attention to the illusion. Don't you pay attention to what people say you are. Listen, know who you are in God. Don't you pay attention to what you see, because what you see is only illusion. What you see is what the enemy wants you to see, because he is the prince of the air. And so he know how to manipulate stuff that make it look a certain way. He know how to manipulate stuff to make it look like you ain't gonna get out of what you in. He know how to manipulate stuff to make it look like you ain't gonna get your bills paid. He know how to manipulate stuff to make it look like God is not gonna supply all of your needs. But wait a minute, come here. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So I haven't seen it yet, but I still have faith, and I still know that it's gonna come to pass, because I walk by faith and not look at your name and say, don't pay attention to the illusion.
Don't pay attention to the illusion.
Hallelujah. Now look at he says, I want you to be strong. Don't pay attention. Don't look at this and compare it to the other. I want you to be strong because God said, I am with you. Then verse 5, he says, according to the word that I convened with you when you came out of Egypt, so my spirit remaineth among you. Fear not. What it's saying is, I got to go back, watch this, to the promise I made to you when you came out of Egypt, that I would never leave you, that my spirit will always dwell with you. And so because I got to stand, because I can't lie. I am not a liar, God says, nor the son of man that I might repent. So I can't lie. So I got to hold on to the word that I gave you in the first place. Amen. And so what he's saying here is that my spirit will never leave you. So don't look at the building. Think about my spirit being wherever you have dedicated for me to be. Think about my spirit being in the place. Don't you look at the outside. Look at the spirit of God that's dwelling in the place. Look at the spirit of God that is remaining among the people. Look at where the spirit of God brought them from. They were taken by the Babylonians. They had to go through Nebuchadnezzar. They had to go through Belshazzar. They had to go through Cyprus. They had to go through Xerxes. But they are still standing. And some of those same ones that were taken over are now allowed to go back to their native land of Jerusalem, where they can worship God in spirit and in truth. So he said, listen, don't you pay attention to the illusion. I want you to know that my spirit will never leave you. Somewhere else he said, I will never leave you or forsake you. You ain't seen nothing yet. He said, my spirit. Anybody just want the presence of God? Yeah. And it don't matter where you are, as long as you got his presence with you, as long as you got his spirit with you. Yeah, I know sometimes you don't want to get up and go to work. Because of what you got to deal with. If you look at it, that's just God's opportunity to show you that he still is God. If I didn't learn anything else this week, I learned that I can solely depend on him and that my flesh is found in it is no good thing. If I learned anything, you can solely depend on God. So it doesn't matter where you are, it matters who you got with you. Are you hearing me today? It doesn't matter where you are. It matters who you got with you. See, sometimes we take us with us. Hallelujah. And us's want to say some stuff. Us's want to do some stuff. Amen. Us's will box you in your mouth because you talk too much. Us's will slap you. Us's will make you want to go get a gun. Us's will make you go get a knife. Us's will make say and cuss you out and say, you better not talk to me like that. You so-and-so. Amen. That's what us will do. But when you got the Spirit of God walking with you, when you got the Spirit of God with you, then us moved out of the way. Now we got the honor him. And so now I look at you and I say, you poor thing, you say what you want to say, but don't you know that no weapon formed against me shall prosper? So you keep on talking, keep on doing, keep on talking behind my back. Because I got the Spirit. Hallelujah. With me. So he said, listen, my spirit remains among you. And so because I have the Spirit, I don't have to fear. Say amen. I don't have to be afraid because I have the Spirit with me. Verse 6, he says, for thus says the Lord of hosts, yet once it is a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land, and I will shake all nations, and the desires of all nations shall come, and I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord. He said, listen, it ain't gonna be long before I shake some stuff up. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
It ain't gonna be long before I shake some stuff up. There are some people that are thorns in our flesh.
Okay.
Say amen.
Okay.
I mean, you trying to do the best that you can. You ain't trying to bother nobody. Matter of fact, you may try to keep to yourself, but there's always somebody bothering you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But don't you know, if you take some stuff and you put it in a box, you could put it in a box one way, but once you close the box and shake it up, when you open the box, it's a different way. And God said, listen, I'm about to shake some stuff up. Some people that are before you that's plaguing you, they ain't going to be able to plague you no more, because I'm going to shake some stuff up. He's saying here, the same nations that bothered you, the same nations that captured you, I'm going to shake some stuff up, and you might have been on the bottom, but because of who you are in me, now you're going to be on the top.
Yes.
I want you to know that these things that are going to happen, you ain't going to see it coming. Because it's not going to happen in a natural way. It's going to happen, it's going to supersede natural, it's going to happen supernaturally, so you won't be able to give nobody else the credit but God. Listen, you're going to be able to get to places that you're not qualified for by the word. You're going to be able to do things that you, the people say you're not qualified for. You're going to be able to go places that people say you will never be able to go. You're going to be able to do things that you were ever, never able to do, but not because of you, but because of God. And he's going to move supernaturally to shake some stuff up. Hallelujah. You ain't seen nothing yet. So listen, I'm gonna shake the heavens, I'm gonna shake the earth. Matter of fact, I'm gonna shake the dry land, I'm gonna shake the water, I'm gonna shake everything up. Nothing gonna be like it was. What is the purpose? The purpose is so this house will be filled with glory. Let me say this. Some of us can't even praise God like we want to, because we have so much stuff on our minds, so many distractions. Even right now, you're trying to listen to me, but something else is on your mind. Listen to what he says. He said, I got to shake some stuff up because I got to have a glory in my house. Listen, when you come into the house of God, there should be nothing else on your mind but God. And so if you're thinking about other stuff, that means that God got to shake some stuff up so your mind can be on him, so that he can get the glory. Hallelujah. When we decide to let God do his thing, we are have, just like we had this morning, we have uninhibited services. When we allow God to do his thing, he will show up in a mighty way. And I don't know if you checked it out, but when the anointing is thick in a place like this, all you can ask for, whatever you need, you can ask for whatever you will. And God is true to his word, because there are certain places and certain atmosphere where you praise the Lord, where you enter in, that you can get exactly what he has for you. That's why I had to just take a little praise break, because I said, God, there's something in here that you want us to have. And yes, we got to move on to the next thing, but God, you are in control. We put you first. Your anointing is first. You are the reason why I came, so I can enter into my agenda and move you to the side. Come on here. Hallelujah.
Yes.
There has to be glory in his house.
Yes.
He goes on to say, the silver is mine, and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. Everything is mine. Hallelujah. So if you thought it was yours, it don't belong to you. The Lord says here that all of it belongs to him. He goes on to say, this is part of it, we can get to, we're going to close out here. He says, the glory of this latter house shall be greater than of the former. Let me stop right there. He says, the glory that's in this house will be greater than the glory that was before.
Yeah.
And I started to ponder that. Solomon's temple was splendid.
Okay.
I mean, it had everything that you would need, that you would want in there. I mean, it was a great edifice. I mean, it was something to behold. It was something to look at. But then God says the glory of this latter house will be greater than the glory of the former. And so I started thinking about the dedication of the temple when Solomon had all the priests in the place and they started to praise God and his anointing came over the place and they could not even perform their duties. The only thing they could do is stop and give God the praise. And I said, wow, even with that, God, how this house is going to be greater than the former house. It's going to be greater because he says that my presence is going to linger with you. It's going to be greater because my presence shall never leave you. It's going to be greater because this edifice that you are in, it don't look like the other one, say amen, but it is going to be used for a greater purpose.
Yes. Amen.
You ain't seen nothing yet. And so now, I started thinking about this temple. I said, wow, okay, so now, you said this one here is going to be greater. The only thing, or one of the things that I could point to as what would make this house so much greater as that this was the actual temple that Jesus was dedicated in. Did you catch that? This was the actual temple where Jesus was dedicated in. This is the actual temple where you found him at 12 years old talking with the elders. It was in this temple. This temple was the place where Jesus would teach the people. This temple was the place where he would heal the man with a withered hand. This temple was the place where he would cast out demons. It was greater work that happened in this temple than it happened in the former. Say amen.
Amen.
This house will be greater than the former. Saying, Lord, amen.
Amen.
He says, and in this place will I give peace, said the Lord of hosts. Now, he said, okay, so this temple is going to be greater.
Uh-huh.
And like I showed you, Jesus walked in this temple. He did miraculous things in this temple. And so it started me thinking, Rodney, about our temple.
Well.
Our temple being, our bodies is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And it started me thinking about our temple because when we allow Jesus to walk in, when we allow Jesus to be dedicated in our temple, y'all ain't caught it yet, amen. When we receive him and allow him to be dedicated in our temple, there are some great things that can be done, amen. Because once you allow Jesus to come in, you say, God, I know I can't do it all on my own. I've been trying to be good. I've been trying to do the right thing, but it can't happen without you. I've got to cast my cares on you. I've got to say to myself, my sins unto you. I got to accept you as my Lord and Savior because you came and died for me so my temple could be cleansed. And so just like Jesus walked into this temple and that made that temple greater than the former, when he walks into our temple, I'm talking about before we knew Christ. I'm talking about when we was out there doing whatever we wanted to do. I'm talking about when we was out there fornicating. I'm talking talking about when we was out there being adulterers. I'm talking about when we were smoking, all that we could smoke and drink, all that we could drink with before he came into that temple. Listen, we were a mess, but once the Lord came in to that temple, now your glory in your latter house will be greater than that of your former house. All you got to do is know to yourself that you ain't seen nothing yet. Whatever you want the Lord to do, you need peace in your house. You ain't seen nothing yet. You see, you need the glory of God in your house. You ain't seen nothing yet. Listen, I used to hang around with Pookie and all of them, but now all I want to do is be in the presence of Almighty God. Listen, you ain't seen nothing yet. The glory that God got in store for you, the faith that God has in store for you. People have told you that you couldn't have it. People have told you that you couldn't get it. People have told you that you're going to fail. People have said, someone should have died in our childhood. But you can step to the devil and say, listen, I'm saved now. You should have killed me when you had the chance. The glory.
Hallelujah.
In this latter house will be greater, hallelujah, than in the former house, said the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, said the Lord. Now this is what I want you to catch. Nobody else said it but God. Amen. There's a charm tongue out now that said, you let the church say amen. God has said it. Spoken it. All we got to do is say amen. What amen means is so be it. All amen means is it is so. Amen. And so if you believe that it is so, give the Lord a hand of praise. If you believe that it is so, clap your hand. If you believe that it is so, tell God thank you. If you believe that it is so, give him glory. If you believe that it is so, of this lamp house. works will you do? Listen, he's just waiting on you to make up in your mind that you're going to run on to see what the end is going to be. He's just waiting on you to make up in your mind that you're going to go with him regardless of what it costs. He's just waiting on you to make up in your mind that whoever I have to leave behind is okay. Because God, you are more important to me than people. You are more important to me than stuff. Where I'm going is better than where I've been. You didn't catch that. Where I'm going is better than where I've been. You ain't seen nothing yet. Don't look at your neighbor, say, neighbor, you ain't seen nothing yet. Oh, tell them to your like it so they can believe it. You ain't seen nothing yet. 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 It's gonna be better than the former glory. Where I'm going, it's gonna be better than where I've been. You ain't seen nothing yet. Hallelujah. 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 All you gotta do is let Jesus come in and do his thing. All you gotta do last week, lighten your load. Get some stuff up off of you. Come and cast your burdens on him. Come and rest in him. God. He is a great God. He is a God to help us in our time of trouble. In the time of trouble, he will hide us. God is so good to us. He's better to us than we've been to ourselves. And all we got to do is put it on him. All we got to do is give it to him. Because you ain't seen nothing yet. Not because of me, but because of the glory of God. Hallelujah. name, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless your name, God. Sometimes we struggle, but the struggle is man-made. God says you ain't seen nothing yet. All you got to do is open up your heart. Open up your heart and let him come in. Let him come in. He said, Jesus says, if you open up the door, he will come in and dwell with you. He will come in and eat with you. But you gotta open the door. You gotta open the door. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on in. Give it over to him. Don't you go another minute. Not another minute. Not another second. Hallelujah. Give it to him. Hallelujah.